Και τώρα μετά από τους πολλούς προλόγους θα έρθουμε στη ήρθε σειρά του Τζόνι. Ο κύριος Τζόνι Χέινμαν είναι γεννημένος το 1965. Είναι παντρεμένος και έχει τρία παιδιά και διαμένει στο Σίλκεμπορκ της Δανίας. Ξεκίνησε την πρώτη του επιχείρηση στο Λύκειο το 1980 και έκτοτε η κύρια απασχόλησή του είναι η δημιουργία και ανάπτυξη μικρομεσαίων επιχειρήσεων. Είναι ιδρυτής και μέλος του Διοικητικού Συμβούλου και συνειδιοκτήτης εταιρείας AG Analytics με γραφεία στο Σίλκεμπορκ και στην Κοπενχάγη. Συμμετέχει σε πολλά διοικητικά συμβούλια επιχειρηματικών και συμβουλευτικών φορέων. Είναι ένας από τους 100 μέντορες που έχουν στην Δανία, το Early Warning Denmark, από το 2013, οι οποίοι αναλαμβάνουν περίπου 500 επιχειρήσεις το χρόνο για ανάκαμψη, ρευστοποίηση περιουσιακών στοιχείων ή και κλείσιμο. Είναι μέλος του Σώματος Εθελοντών Συμβούλων του Early Warning Denmark και πρόεδρος των εθελοντών μεντόρων της περιφέρειας Midland. Έχει επίσης κάνει δημοσιεύσεις σχετικά με το σχεδιασμό ερωτηματολογίου «Ένας πρακτικός οδηγός για καλύτερες απαντήσεις» και μια συνδυαστική ανάλυση, επίσης ένας πρακτικός οδηγός για προστιθέμενη αξία από τα δεδομένα της ανάλυσης, σε ό,τι αφορά την ανάλυση των στοιχείων των επιχειρήσεων για να δούμε ποιες είναι σε κρίση. Επίσης είναι διαιτητικό μέλος της διοίκησης του πολιτικού κόμματος Liberal Alliance, μέλος των επιχειρηματικών συλλόγων ΕΣΟΜΑΡ και ΜΠΙΚ για περισσότερο από 10 χρόνια και μέλος του κλαμπ των 100 μάραθων της Δανίας, Ένωση Μαραθωδρόμων, που έχουν ολοκληρώσει περισσότερους από 100 επίσημους μαραθώνιους. Σήμερα ήρθα από το ξενοδοχείο μέχρι εδώ, φυσικά δεν το συζητάμε. Και μάλιστα έκανε και λάθος και πήγε προς τη Συγκρού και ήρθα και είπα: έκανε μια δοκιμή, αλλά οι συνθήκες δεν είναι ίδιες. Εδώ έχουμε ζέστη. Στη Δανία έχει κρύο. Τζόνι, ο λόγος σε σένα.
First of all, thank you for inviting me and thank you for this nice introduction. I could recognize a few words. So it's so good to see so many of you show up today. It's a good start, I believe, in a great future for early warning in Greece. Before we start the seminar, I'd like to tell you that I've been with Early Warning Denmark for 5 years, and personally I have been involved with 25 companies as a mentor during those 5 years. Today I have selected a sample of cases that I will share with you. These cases will show some of the variety you can meet as a volunteer mentor. It will show some of the dilemmas you can run into, some of the challenges, and I will also allow myself to challenge you on the way and ask you questions and then reply with the way I choose to handle the situation. I hope you are okay with that. Later on today, you will have to do a group exercise because an important part of being a volunteer mentor is the network. You're part of a very powerful network. The network can benefit you and the company you're trying to help in many ways. For instance, the biggest mistake one can make is to believe that you know everything yourself. So address reality with some humbleness. If you yourself have been an entrepreneur, racing toward the stars and going into bankruptcy, you will know what humbleness means. From one of the slides, I noticed that the SMEs were mentioned as the backbone of society, and that's a very true statement. In Denmark, as well as in Greece, we have a lot of SMEs, and they're like the backbone of our society in many ways. The challenge is that many of the SMEs stay small, or they die before they really take off. And that's a challenge for us to look at today also. These cases I have chosen, they will reflect mostly the human side of the business owner, and not so much the figures, because many of you are educated people and will know how to read figures. So the most interesting part in this work is actually the human beings. How does a mentor interact with a person in distress? But of course, to keep a rational mind is a very important part as the job also, because whenever we enter, the business owner is always part of the problem. The business owner has lost the overview, typically, and banks and tax department and creditors are screaming to get some real plan for what's going to happen if they're going to work with this company in the future. And early warning entering in this process usually means hope for everyone. So there's a lot of expectation on your shoulders when you take a job as a volunteer mentor. And being voluntarily also means that you have to do it with your heart. You have to do it because you believe it is important. That is a fundamental thing for being a good mentor. Please feel free to ask questions during the presentation of these cases. Just raise your hand and I will point at you. If you have mobile phones, please put them on silent so they will not disturb today's seminar. Okay. When I left, let's see how this works. No. Yes. When I left Denmark yesterday, it looked like this. And just 3 days ago, actually meetings were cancelled because people could not drive safely. So it's like coming to another world here, a more pleasant place than the place I left. But not only concerning the weather are there differences to our countries. There are also cultural differences. There are differences in the way we operate with business, the way we interact with people, etc. Which means that when I unfold my cases, please bear with me that it happened in Denmark and it happened under the Danish way of doing things, the Danish law, etc. And it might be different here, and just take it as an inspiration. Okay. This company experienced rapid growth. Actually, he was started by a guy. This is not the real guy, but someone similar. All the photos I'm showing are not real. All cases are real. First-hand experience, I was there myself. Okay? He expanded rapidly, and when he called early warning, he just got his recent annual report, and the bank said, you are in a deep crisis. Red figures, and we want our money back. He had about 40, you know, buses, taxis, transportation for school children, handicap driving, etc. Okay, so what happened? First he was one, then he was nearly 50 employees. money was rolling in. The sky was the limit. He took chances like a lot of SMEs do. It's part of the nature that when you are very young and inexperienced, you're very flexible. You look at everything as an option. When you get older, you get things more controlled. And when you get them too controlled, you end up in bureaucracy, and eventually you die, just like a human being. So of course, the trick is to build the company, organize it, because some organization is necessary. But these entrepreneurs usually are not very well organized. They just find something that is they can sell, and they sell it, and they sell it, and they sell it, and they grow without organizing, because organizing is a waste of money at this stage, until the bank calls and say, we want our money back. And they did. What happened? This company, it turned out, had entered some bad contracts. Actually, contracts with work, which meant they had to hire people, but with no profit margins, because some of the on the cost side was not taken into account, which meant that the more they worked, the poorer they got, because they lost money. And these were contracts running for a certain period of time, so it's not like a really bad situation. Because of the lack of organizing, they had no idea what was hitting them before it was actually too late. So we had to act very quickly to negotiate with the bank, and before they would even talk to us, we needed an overview of the situation. Where was the money made? Where was the money lost? And the entrepreneur did not really know. He had an assumption how it worked, but he did not really know. He was in his late 30s, so still a young man, just became father for the second time. And actually, he had spent every cent building this company. All his pension funds, all his house, everything was at stake. At the way to the bank, he even suffered from a heart attack, which meant that he went to the hospital and were unable to run his business for a while, and the business was in a bad condition because the money was lost. We made analysis of each car, each bus. We took it out as a profit center, isolated it, said, okay, how much does it cost to run this bus alone? How much profit do we make? How can we increase the profit? We took that item by item, and it showed up that there were some areas they lost a lot of money. This was this contract-based driving that they taken on recently. And there were some good areas where they actually were profitable. But in the business owner's mind, the harder we work, the better, which is not always the case. Actually, you can often, by analyzing where the profit is and do some sort of twin analysis to look in the market and see, are there more profitable customers like the one we are good serving, and who actually provides us with profit out in the market? And the question is usually yes, because a lot of these entrepreneurs, they're flexible, which is a strength, but they need to use the flexibility wisely. Then they're actually very powerful. I will come back to that. Today, because what happened? Actually, I would say this is a case of not early warning, but more late warning. And this is a typical problem. especially if you are a man, at least that goes for Denmark. If you are a man and you're very proud, you will not ask for help. And he was a guy who would not ask for help until it was, I mean, 1 minute before we close. It was unfortunately too late to rescue. So this went into a process of reconstruction to save as much as could be saved. And I will say that with the bank, with the tax department, et cetera, et cetera, creditors, we had very good, very professional negotiations, and we found a solution. Today, the family can stay in the house. Today, he runs a company which is smaller, of a size that he can manage, and he makes a very, very nice profit, and have around 10, 12, 14 employees today, which is not 50, but it's better than nothing. I will come back to this psychological aspect of size. What's the correct size of a business for a business owner, and vice versa? Okay. Any questions so far? No. Next one. As you can see, is a female. She came early, which is good, because when a business owner in distress contacts early, warning early, it leaves you as a mentor with more options, with more scenarios and possible ways to find good solutions. If they come very late, unfortunately, it's often too late. She came in good time, and actually, she's one of our entrepreneurs who really tried to do things the right way. First, let me explain what she's doing. She's one very famous in her niche in design, restoration of ancient buildings. I'm sure in Greece she would have a lot to do. She's a specialist, and all the magazines, they portrait her, and you sit with a bad hand, but you need to play it the best way possible. That's what you're there for. You're not there to judge them or to make them feel bad. You're there to help them, but you are using your valuable time, and you should use your valuable time with people who can be helped. It's very important. Okay?
Can be helped.
Can be helped. He wanted to be helped. He wanted. He wanted more money so he could gamble more. Help me raise more money.
To get better is very important.
That's right. But I think this...
I'm smoking, you don't want to.
No.
Smoking.
But you're weak.
Yeah, you can't work.
Yes.
He was unlucky though, because like a self-employed, anybody from his family could do his job for him.
Yeah.
He was unlucky a bit.
Maybe also, but of course these are for other specialists, like the gambling center to make the diagnostics. I cannot do that. What does this person need to be helped, etc. But he needs to take the first step and contact them, and then they can take over. But and if he cannot convince himself to do that, I cannot. It's the same.
Send them first.
Yes. And this is the factor that is sometimes omitted, but this actually is the most determining factor with the SMIs. That's the psychology of the business owner, the behavior, sometimes irrational behavior. As I said earlier, they're always part of the problem, and they have lost the overview, which also means that the things they tell you, maybe they believe it's true, but it is not necessarily true, because they're in some sort of a denial at the same time, and it's a mixture of hope combined with it's like being in the forest and not be able to see all the trees because you're too much involved, too much in the situation. Okay. Sometimes, and this has actually from those 25 businesses I have worked with become quite a speciality for me, something that I do as a specialist now, that is helping businesses with more than one owner, two or more owners who are in conflict to solve the conflict. Either so they can continue or so they can separate. I don't know how it is in Greece, but in Denmark we have a lot of companies with more than one owner, two or three, here also, excellent. Then this is worth paying attention to. Because there's a valuable process that I have discovered how to help businesses with more than one owner who are in a conflict. Being in a conflict between owners is terrible because it has a tendency to confuse, and that's the least that it does. It confuses the employees, confuses the customers, and even the owners themselves. So everybody's confused, and this is not a very good momentum for running a business. So you need to clarify who is running the business and who is not running the business and how is it done. And it's not just something that's nice, it's something that you need to do. But how is it done? That's the difficult part. And we're back speaking about trust, because you can never run a process of a mediation with people who do not trust you. Because what's really, really needed is that they open their hearts to you and they believe that what they tell you goes nowhere else. But if you're in that position, if you're able to build that form of trust, you can provide miracles with businesses with more than with two or more owners. I will explain how, but first I will illustrate it with this case. This couple, were a married couple, and they had built a company together, employing about 100 people in doing cleaning services for other businesses and doing some gardening as well. They were working like mad, and they thought that okay, now it's a good idea to like educate ourselves a bit. So they went for a course, and this course was about setting goals and where do we want to be in the future and what will bring us there, etc. You know, they went for a course like that together, and then afterwards, during this process, they worked like, where do you see yourself in 5 years and me and so on, and the wife. In this process, discovered that maybe I don't have the right husband. So she's told him, okay, maybe it's time to split. Okay, we didn't plan for that. Also, not with our business, that this should happen. So we have no owners agreement regulate, how will we split the business, how will we set the value for the business, etc. So everything points to chaos. And that's another good example of contacting early warning, early. They did. And they did because one of them had heard about an early warning volunteer mentor helping a company. This company had told about it. And they said, okay, we need that help as well. So me, with some knowledge, some experience in splitting owners, etc., I went into splitting a marriage couple in terms of business. And that was a very fruitful process, because, and I must say that if looking aside from this human irrationality that we all possess to some degree, and which is more visible the more stressed we are, then this couple was actually phenomenal. They were like, they were speaking nice about each other, they were caring about each other, though they were, of course, in some sadness at the same time. But this was a very positive experience for me as well. We ended up, and here I asked for advice in my early warning network to find the valuation of the company, because I mean there's not like a list you can see. Okay, the company should cost this. Normally, it's a matter of negotiation between parties, or you have an agreement already that sets the rule for how you sell your shares in a company. But not in this case, and not in many cases I've seen, that people tend to just like, they find a stupid template online and then they fill it out, and that's then their owner's agreement, which is not good enough. If the company becomes valuable and you would like to run it, you need to make sure that your like foundation of the company is done right, in the right way. And this is needed the minute you are more than one owner. Then you need a good, solid owner's agreement regulating what will we do if we end up in a conflict. It's much easier when you're good friends. It's much easier before things go wrong. Because if you imagine three guys building a company together, it becomes enormous, successful, profitable, and then they hang out together socially, and then one of the men finds one of the other partner's wives attractive, and you have all the trouble. And that's the real world, I'm sorry. And suddenly you have a company with no management, or they're fighting every day, and it's such a pity, especially when the company is a good company, and there's value to save, there are employees, jobs to save. If you can fix this, this thing between men and women, but not always between men and women, of course, but in this case it was like that. The way we did it, and here comes the approach, if you have more than two or more owners in conflict or potential conflict, you have sessions with them together. Inform them that you are there to help as a mediator. They sit there with you voluntarily. Nobody is enforcing them. At any time they can leave. But we're trying to find the best possible solution for both of them. And if there are more than two, if there are three or four, they all four attend this common information, where they will get the instructions, how does it work. That when we talk individually, it's between only you and me. The others will never hear what we have been discussing. And I will go very to the point with each one of you, because in order to help you, I need to know your positions. I need to know your thoughts. without knowing them, how can we move forward? And it has worked very well in many ways, because first of all, when people open up, they feel a sort of a relief that now actually somebody is listening. They have tried to say this a million times, but nobody's listening. Suddenly there's a person there who is listening and taking him or her seriously. And that actually goes, no matter where they are in a position to the company or to each other, it's the same for everybody. Everyone needs to be understood, needs to feel that they're heard. Sometimes what they will tell you doesn't make sense necessarily, but to them it makes sense. But then by asking questions, by being friendly, you can guide them to new understandings. You can actually move them. And to find solutions, you have to move people. And there's no way around it. And to do so, of course, when I tell it, it may sound easy. It's not necessarily easy, but it's extremely rewarding to have a process. Very often, it's not done over a long period. It's done over a short period, and you will see immediate results. Situations loosen up, and people can move forward. They would not have been able to move forward if it had not been for you. If you had not been there, they wouldn't exist as a company or as a group anymore. So I can strongly recommend to, if you have more than one owner, and maybe some you feel that they're in a disagreement, take them separately. Not necessarily as a process, but talk to them individually to find out what's going on. Does it make sense? Okay. Sorry?
What was finally the solution for them? What did you?
Yes. I came with suggestions after having spoken to them individually and at a new meeting with both of them present. And we agreed that the man should continue the company and that the wife should sell her shares. And they were both happy about that solution. We got the evaluation for the company, and we had their own accountant to verify it. We have discussions with the bank. And there's no right and wrong. You can negotiate a price anytime. But here there was a sort of a fairness. She wanted to leave. She accepted that the man should have a good possibility to run the business. But the case was solved in a very, very nice way. I had another situation. I'd like to mention that in relationship to this mediation, because it was two people who had merged their companies and then ran into huge disagreements about how to manage it. Because, I mean, men and business owners, and they have their own way, and suddenly they have to work together. And of course, when you're dreaming and you're at the stage where you have all the opportunities and so on, but then when it becomes everyday life and you see the way the other person is doing things you wouldn't have done that way, etc., there can easily be a conflict. And it happened in this case. We actually had this process. We negotiated who should sell and who should buy. Everything's fine. Until the moment that the papers were being prepared with the lawyer to be signed so the shares could shift hands. This is a company with about 20 employees. And then the one owner who should sell, he went to the company physically to pick up some personal belongings, like I have a smartphone, an iPad, whatever, a picture of my dog, and things like that. And then the other owner, he saw him coming physically to the company. Said, okay, what are you doing here? Well, I'm here to pick up my phone, the picture of my dog, and my iPad. You don't take the iPad. It's mine. Okay, then I do not want to make an agreement. The lesson learned, when you have an agreement, fix it. Not in 2 weeks, now. Fix it. If the lawyer says, okay, we have it in 2 weeks, no, we need it now. We need it now, we need it now. It's crazy, but it's true. It took 4 months to get it back on track. 4 months where the company was, what will happen, or am I going bankrupt? And because the one owner was not there. He had his lawyer write that now the price had 10-doubled for selling his shares because he couldn't get this iPad. And then we had the bank to interfere and say to the owner who should sell, you sell or you're finished. And then it happened. Okay. Today the company is doing well and still expanding, now with him as the only owner. And the wife got her. Yeah. Okay. Yes, we're now. Okay. Yes, we have a break after the summary here, which is part of the first session. What we do, the value we provide, we bring new rational outlook without emotions and judgment. The owner can't see the forest for trees are deeply in, has lost the overview, maybe in some sort of depression at the same time. The bank needs some plan, what's up and what's down, and they might also be worried because when they try to call the business owner, he doesn't reply, or they send him things and he comes back with some bullshit and so on. What we offer is to create this overview and to help build this plan, if there is a plan to be built. The business owner can be in denial, as we have spoken about. Assumptions can be completely wrong. And after the break, I will give you examples of that. And irrational behavior is actually our worst enemy, because it creates worry with the creditors, with the bank, with the people who actually you depend upon to negotiate good solutions and to find a way forward. Good employees will leave the company because they can go elsewhere, and you end up with employees who cannot go elsewhere, but who you would like to see go elsewhere. But so it goes very fast the wrong way. And then an important thing to note is that the limit is set by the business owner. You will fail if you try to transform a pony into a racing horse. It cannot be done, and it shouldn't be done. It's important that the shoe fits the foot if you are to walk or run with the shoe. And you cannot have, like we had in the first case, a business owner who has a lot of employees, a lot of commitments, who has lost the overview because he's bad, poorly organized. You can't have that. Then you need to scale the business to fit what he can manage, and then he's successful. You find a shoe of the right size to fit the person, or you change the foot. That's the thing. And then, of course, not all company owners should own a business. It's obvious. And some businesses are redundant. maybe they were some, maybe they had a function, a mission, some value to contribute with 10 years ago, but that does not mean it's the same today or will be the same tomorrow, because competition changed the marketplace. Some will die, some will live, and that's part of the life. So thank you for now. See you after the break. Okay. Sorry, that was Christian.
For after the break, can you give us an example, two examples? First, of a failure, your failure, when something you proposed didn't work. And later you found out you have, you had to make some to suggest something else, but you found out later the first suggestions you made was wrong. And another example of when you sit down, talk to entrepreneur, and you found out that he has covered all the angles, and you have nothing to propose to him. You couldn't say anything. You say I can't suggest anything to you about what we are saying. Thank you. This is the question.
Okay. It might take a few minutes more. Okay. Thank you for these questions. The cases that hurt most are the cases where you see that you can actually help, but it's not the response is different, and you actually can't find out why. I had a startup meeting with a business owner, and everything in my eyes went fine by the book, good chemistry. We agreed on the situation, etc., and what to do. And then she disappeared, and I wondered, did I say something wrong? What was what's happening? And I haven't to this day found out. So you need situations like that. And then of course also this business owner who had the heart attack, it makes you wonder where's the balance between pushing to a solution. We need to do this. Like for instance, you have probably many of you have tried a toothache where you have a tooth hurting, and you know that, okay, the way to handle it is to go to the dentist. But you could also go several months by taking some medicine to and hope that it is going away by itself. Seldom it doesn't. You need to get it done and then feel the relief, and you can move forward. And it's sort of the balance here that I had one actually, which was very in a very bad condition. He was in stress. He was behind black curtains. He was lying like a baby in the stomach for a foster. Okay, never mind. He was acting like someone who was not alive, and he was the owner. And he was the director of an IT company. And it was not him who contacted us, it was his father who said, can you help to find us find a solution to this company? But it's very, very difficult to find this is the right, this is the wrong, because it's much more complex. And it's also a matter of trying to sense the capabilities of the person you are dealing with. Where are their limits? Often people can do much more than they believe themselves, but of course there's a certain limit, and you need them to be open. And the really stressful factor is that it needs to be done fast and swift, because otherwise the damage is too big. But maybe I will address it in one of the later sessions, if that's okay. Maybe we'll come back to it. Okay?